So I'm going to tell you something. If you want to know anything about wilderness, you need some wildness in the mind. So you have to think out of the box. And I will give a short presentation about the ideas about it. And it's about the discovery of the missing pages in the Book of Culture, but also in the book about language, because language plays a very important role in if you want to know what wilderness really was. So this is the outline of my presentation. I will go first into the paradigm of the closed canopy forest, because that's for everybody the icon of the wilderness in Europe. So Britain would have been covered from the bottom to the top, from Cornwall to John O'Groats Road, with John's tapestry of forest. And then I will tell you about this paradigm, in fact, evaluated the park-like landscape, which was, in my opinion, everywhere in Europe. And then I will make clear how the park-like landscape is the closest modern analog of the wilderness. And then I will reveal this in the meaning of the history of the words. And that means that words remain the same, but the meaning evolves. And that's the biggest pitfall if you do historical research. And then I tell how modern forestry, which was invented in the 19th century, covered it all up. And therefore, it in fact remained a closed book for us. Europe became totally cultivated, as you can see on this picture. This is an old picture from the 19th century in Belgium about the Helens. And because of that, that cultivation species became extinct. And I mentioned two of them because they play a very important role in my presentation. It's the aurochs. It became extinct in 1627. And the last specimen, a cow, died in what was called the forest of Jaktorowska, that was near Warszawa. And the tarpan, the aurochs is the wild ancestor of all our cattle, and the tarpan, the wild ancestor of all our domestic horses, which became extinct in the 19th century. The big thing of it is that we lost, therefore, the guild of the true grazers. That means the animals that were specialized grass eaters. And other species like deer, wild boar, European bison, they were left in very low numbers or even locally became extinct because of hunting and poaching. So what is the wilderness in Europe? And I mean, what could wilderness be in Europe? And how did it look like in the past? Not that we want to go back to the past, but we can learn from it how the system worked as a ecosystem. If you have a dictionary, you take it and then you will see wilderness is an uncultivated region, like a forest or a desert. So that's the icon which everybody grows up with. So if this picture is seen, what would have been the wilderness here? Not the people which are making hay, of course. And again, the dictionary says it is a large tract of land that has not been significantly affected by human activity. And then you know that's nowhere in Europe. Perhaps some summits of mountains, but further on it's gone. In my opinion, wilderness can also be a large tract of land that has not been significantly affected anymore by human activity. So it could be brought again to be emerged. But the question is, what do you need for circumstances to have it emerge? One of the first person really made a theory about what the wilderness was, you see here, the German forester von Cotta. He wrote a landmark book. It was published in 1816 and then reprinted and reprinted. And he said in 1816, if mankind would leave Germany within 100 years, it would be totally covered with forest. And in fact, that didn't change that idea. So on abandoned agricultural land, you see always that a forest develops spontaneously. So that's a fact. that's not a theory. If you leave here the grassland or you leave arable land, it will be invaded by trees and eventually it will become a forest. And so in this way, the closed canopy forest became the baseline for wilderness because it is something without any more any human influence. And in fact, that idea was formalized in 1916 by an American, Edward Clements, and he said it all started with a pioneer vegetation, bare soil, then you get grasses and shrubs coming up, and finally you get the trees, and on every place where trees can grow according to hydrology or according to climate, you will have a forest. The British scientist Arthur George Tansley took this over, the same theory, and he introduced the concept of the ecosystem. And he also said you have first a pioneer vegetation, then an intermediate one, and then a climax. And because trees and shrubs grow taller than grasses, he said all of Europe would have been covered by a forest, because eventually the trees would win the competition over grasses and shrubs for daylight. So you have what they call a linear succession towards the forest, and the forest remains a forest. That's the idea. And he says, because Europe was covered with a closed canopy forest, wild herbivores like red deer, the aurochs, which was present until the 17th century, do not alter the forest. If they do, it is not a good case. They follow the succession. And so with all those animals, you have always a forest. However, we know that if you have certain densities of those large herbivores, they are able to alter the forest because they can destroy the seedlings and the saplings. And that's the reason that all these herbivores are culled, are shot to densities that they don't harm the forest. So that's the idea, not only about the wilderness as vegetation, but also the wilderness as the house of our wild ungulate animals, our herbivores. So because of the theory of the closed canopy forest, all large mammals are considered to be forest animals, like here the European bison in the forest of Białowieża. And because they can damage the forest, you see here the bison debarking a tree and then the tree will die, they must naturally have lived in very low densities. Otherwise there could not have been a forest. And some people say it were the large predators that made them living in such low densities. So connected with that theory is that large predators regulate the number of ungulates to a level that we have everywhere a closed canopy forest. So you see now that we have as a measurement, as a baseline for naturally, 3 to 5 bison per 1,000 hectares. That's even what the WWF says. And for red deer, 1 to 3 red deer per 100 hectares. So if you have 100 hectares of forest, you will never see a red deer. That's how scarce they will be. And it's not only deer that are culled, because to bring them back to densities that they do not harm the forest, but even bison, which are still on the red list of the IUCN as a threatened animal, is shot to keep them low, otherwise they damage the forest. So the closed canopy forest as a baseline for the undisturbed wilderness was the baseline in Europe as for the wilderness. And from that wilderness, people came in the Stone Age with their stone axes. They cut the trees, opened up the land for their arable land, and they sent in they grazed the animals there, and they drove them into the forest where they destroyed the seedlings and the saplings. And so the closed canopy forest slowly changed into a park-like landscape, and eventually it became grassland or it became heath. And so we developed our cultural landscapes. And this is what we know, this landscape with the wildflowers and the wild fauna that we were going to consider as natural. And so this picture is considered the most ideal situation and the most diverse for preservation, for nature conservation. And that's the reason that most nature conservation want to preserve agricultural land, because they think if we have not agricultural land, we will end in a dark, dull, close canopy forest, and we will lose all those species which cannot thrive in this forest. And the only one who can preserve that is man, or originally the farmer. So the farmer creates the biodiversity which we all want to preserve and we appreciate so much. And look, this is a famous vegetation scientist, Heinz Alleberg, and he wrote in his book Central Look to the Semantics, how he used language to make you in favor of this landscape. Central Europe would have been a monotonous wooded landscape if mankind had not created the colorful mosaic of fields, heaths, haylands and pastures. Who wants a monotonous wooded landscape? Nobody. And who wants the colorful mosaic of fields, heaths, haylands and pastures? Everybody. So even in the presentation of a scientific phrase, he already draws you into his ideas about this landscape. And what about large herbivores? Yes, a horse. And how do we consider these large herbivores, for instance, in nature management, a mowing machine on four legs? So there has been millions of years of evolution, and what did we get? A mowing machine. And based on pollen analysis, the pollenologists claim to have confirmed that the natural vegetation was a closed canopy forest. And how? They look to pollen from the end of the Ice Age unto the present. And here you see the percentages of pollen. And then you see this period that's very important. It's between 8,000 and 5,000 years before present. Because that is supposed to be the period that all the trees that returned to Europe after the Ice Age were there, while the farmers did not arrive in Europe. They should have arrived so around after 5,000 before present. And when they counted the pollen, and you know the pollen are given, this is an oak and these are the flowers, and they are release pollen into the air, and that's how they go to other trees and finally form their seeds. So wind pollinated trees give an idea of whether they were present or not, because the pollen that are released to the air, they sedimentate in raised bogs where they are preserved for thousands and thousands of years. And then pollenologists took them out of the raised bog and started to count and said, look, if I count, I found that 95% of the pollen are from trees. So they say, you were right, it is a closed canopy forest because the vegetation is dominated by trees. There's also hazel, but they say hazel is a shrub that grows underneath the canopy of the trees. And look, these are the percentages of pollen they find from grasses. And it's 5%, so very low, so it means there was hardly any grassland. So, in fact, it was the confirmation, and that, in fact, was also the end of the debate, which was going on until then. How did our originally natural landscape look like? So, in historic documents, scientists read words silva, forest, wald, and woud. These things you find in charters going back to, let's say, the 6th and the 7th century onwards. And this is Latin, and this is what they call, this is also from Latin, and this is what they call the common language the people used. And nowadays, all these words mean, if you look in the dictionary, a closed canopy forest. So even the historians say, yes, even the text supports the theory. So there's hardly any doubt left. And they often refer to Tacitus. He was a Roman man living 100 years after Christ. And he described Germania, which is the present Germany, as terra etsi aliquanto specie differt in universum tamen aut sylvis horrida aut paludibus fovida. I'm not a classical man, so I pronounce it probably totally wrong. And this is translated that the Germanic tribes, because it was also part of the Netherlands, it was not Germans, but it were Germanic. Their lands, however, somewhat different in aspect, yet taken altogether, consist of gloomy forest or nasty marshes. So they said, look, even the Romans who went into an almost uncultivated area, they just said also it was a closed canopy forest. So again, Europe was covered by a closed canopy forest. However, we must realize that whole construction, which I just presented, didn't take into account any influence of large herbivores. On forehand, it was said they didn't have influence, like what Tensley said, and I just showed you. So this vegetation is there if there are not these animals. Or they are in such low densities that they do not harm this vegetation. So in fact, they have been excluded from the reconstruction of the primeval vegetation. And that's a very important thing to realize. Going to the history, everywhere in Europe, livestock was grazed in the wilderness. This is a picture of Pieter Bruegel the Older. And the people didn't have pastures as only grassland as we have it now, and then a forest next to it. No, it was the wilderness, the outside, which they used for their animals. And scientists, like Tensley said, livestock grazing degraded the forest, the wilderness in Europe, into a park-like wood pasture. So the wood pasture was in fact a degraded high forest, because the animals, like this one, prevented the regeneration. So you would see some very old oaks left. No regeneration, there's grassland. And finally, when they die, it will be open grassland. That's the idea. These wood pastures, however, were very much appreciated by painters. Especially, this is a painting from the Forêt de Fontainebleau. It's from the school of Barbizon. And that school has been important because these people wanted to preserve these very nice trees in this open landscape. And you must understand that the Forêt de Fontainebleau was about, I think, 15,000 hectares. And it was grazed by thousands of cattle and pigs. So it was open landscape, as the forester would say, a degraded high forest because of the large ungulates. And those painters, they wanted to preserve it, and they established the oldest forest reserve in Europe in 1853 and 1861. Here you see a lot of paintings of the Forêt. But realize, this was called the Forêt. Well, the modern meaning of a forêt is a closed canopy forest. So the name is not what it showed. And it was not only paintings. These are old pictures from the 18th century, so 1860s. So you see, it was not fantasy what those painters painted. It was the reality. And this is a very famous Dutch painter, Barend Cornelis Koekoek. It's in the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam. And you see, very big open grown oaks. And who made them? They are here, the herders with the cattle. So these landscapes were very much appreciated. However, they were considered as destroyed high forest. So what I said, they degraded the livestock, the wilderness, the natural forest. So if you want to restore the natural situation, you have to get rid of them. And that started all over Europe in the 19th century to close those wood pastures for cattle grazing and then shooting down the red deer to densities they did not harm the regeneration anymore. And so all former wood pastures in the Netherlands, in Europe, changed into closed canopy forest. And in fact, it was one big experiment. And what you saw, the result of that experiment is all light demanding tree species, both species of oak, pedunculate oak, sessile oak, but also the wild pear, the wild fruit species, the wild apple, the wild cherry, the bird cherry, they all disappeared. And if you look to this oak, which is almost dead, you see the thick branches here. This was an oak that grew up in the open, and when the animals were removed, then here beaches came up and they killed this oak. And that's what happened. And for instance, here we have a diagram of a national park. And that national park was established to preserve biodiversity. But the fact is, there was a huge loss of biodiversity. This is pedunculate oak, and look, hardly or no regeneration anymore, and the old days, old trees are dying out, and you have a bell-forming population. This is beech, this is light-demanding, this is beech, shade-tolerant, this is ash, shade-tolerant, and this is elm, shade-tolerant. And they have a so-called inverse G-curve, that means a lot of seedlings and saplings, and then by self-thinning, they become less and less. However, when this one disappeared, there is already a new generation coming up, which is not the case with the oak. And this is a dying out population, and this is a healthy population. And that happens in all the former wood pastures, which are now forest reserves. And even in this national park, in 40 years, 50% of all the vascular plant species were lost. And that's a tragedy, because of a certain theory about nature. You want to preserve nature, but you get the opposite. You lose it. But still the people say, no, this is all right. So that loss of biodiversity is a consequence of going back to the natural conditions. So here in Foret-de-Fontainebleau, the last oaks are falling down, and the whole former Reserve Artistique, where I showed you the picture of the Forêt de Fontainebleau, is now a dark beech hornbeam forest. And why was it developed like this? Because the painter said you should do nothing. But they didn't know how it worked. And not doing anything proved to be a disaster because there was no grazing anymore. However, if there are good marsh years, there are millions of seedlings of oak you can see here. And what I want to show you is what happens. Small leaf lime and broad leaf lime, those are two, these two, they are very shade tolerant tree species. And these are the two oak species, sessile oak and pedunculate oak, and they are very light demanding species. All four species grow very well in open daylight, 100% daylight. None of them grows in total darkness. The interesting thing is what happens in between. That means there is not full daylight, but there is not full dark situation. And then you see that lime outcompetes all the oaks. And you end up in a lime forest. Some people would say, yes, but oak is a light demanding tree species, and therefore if you have wind-blown areas, like you see here in the Forêt de Fontainebleau, that's the chance for the oak and it will come up. Yes, but before you can see it was a closed canopy. There were beeches, and they also produced seedlings and saplings. And they also now are in full daylight, and they go up as well. And in the competition of the of growing up together, beech seedlings, saplings, and oak seedlings and saplings, oak loses. So eventually, this will be a situation with only oak, beech and hornbeam, no oak. So the point is that the disappearance of oak in what is supposed to be the primeval situation is not covered by the pollen diagrams, because in the period there was a full developed forest, and that's the period between 8,000 and 5,000 years. They call it the Atlanticum. You see, there is oak. Oh, sorry. There is oak, but it is together with shade-tolerant tree species. But the important thing is there is oak. So oak did not disappear. How can? So there is something which is not in concordance between the theory and the facts. Oak regenerates very well in a wood pasture. How? The wood pasture will also explain us the description of the German Tacitus. This is a wood pasture. It's a park-like landscape. This is the Bork and the Paradies. These are the grasslands, and these are the trees, the groves, as I call them, together as clumps of trees. So you see, it's a very diverse landscape. It is not simply covered totally by forest. The question is, how do trees regenerate in a wood pasture? Here you see thorny hawthorn, and they nurse an oak. That means they act as natural barbed wire, which prevent the large herbivores that graze here in the grassland to damage this oak. And they don't eat the hawthorn because it has those big spines. It is like barbed wire. And so you get open-grown oaks. They rise up from the hawthorn and spread their crowns, and you get those majestic trees you can find in parks. Here you see the thorn is slow, the black thorn. The black thorn spreads with root suckers into the grassland. So you get a scrub. And this scrub also, what you can see, nurses oak seedlings. Also other seedlings, like from hornbeam and also from lime, but many oaks. And so you get a clump of trees surrounded by thorny scrub. And I call this a grove. And why are there so many oaks compared to other tree species in this mantle and fringe vegetation, as it is called, the scrub? That's because of the jay. The jay hoards the acorns here in the fringes because these shrubs, they act as a beacon for the jay, that in the winter he hoards thousands of acorns. In the autumn he takes them from the oaks and buries them here around, and in the winter he digs them up and he eats them. So it is a kind of winter, what he stored for the winter. And also in the spring he finds them, and then you see in the spring he comes with his young. He looks to seedlings and he sees on the color of the stem whether it's green or brown. If it's green, it's a seedling from a seed he buried the autumn before. He goes to the seedling, pulls it a little bit from the soil until the acorn comes up above the ground. The acorn is still attached to the root of the taproot of the oak. He takes the acorn and feeds it to his young. And the oak seedling is a little bit uprooted, but not totally uprooted, and he grows further. And he grows further in a situation of which foresters said, this is the best situation for an oak to grow up, namely with his head in full daylight. So this is the one that plants the acorns, making the oak, forming the groves and the open-grown oaks. And here you see oaks coming up from the scrub, but also the lime. But the lime doesn't have a jay that plants its seed. Its seed must be dispersed by the wind. So it's by accident that it comes here in that scrub. And here you see the blackthorn. And then the oaks grow up bigger and bigger, and they disappear because they're light demanding. They can't bear the shade that's cast by the canopy by these trees. But what you also see, the youngest trees are on the outside and the oldest trees are here, because these trees also started here with blackthorn. But when they grew up, they drove the blackthorn to the outside because it can't bear shade. It needs daylight. And here you see the trees in the grove. And what you see is they have forest grown canopies. So in a wood pasture you find open grown canopies and you find forest grown canopies. But the most important thing is there is no or hardly any shrub layer. It is hollow. And then you see you got the clump of trees, a grove surrounded by the thorny scrub. And that thorny scrub is called in old text the hedge, which we still have that word, but now it is planted thorn. But this is the natural way a hedge is formed. And here you see this grove is over here, and this is the tree I showed you which came up from the hawthorn. And you see the stipple typically formed, that is because the blackthorn spreads in this way. And then when the trees become old, you get a cap in the canopy, and grazing large herbivores prevent the regeneration. And you see this is an open grown beech. So this is one of the first one who became established and then surrounded by others. And then there are the animals, and they prevent the regeneration of trees. And so the grove becomes open, more open, and the grassland becomes bigger and bigger. And then finally is what we see here, the grove changes in open grassland. To give you some idea of the measurement, here is a couple lying, sitting together, enjoying the landscape. This is in the New Forest. And look, this is how it looks like from Google Maps. And you see the larger crown, the older trees are in the inside, and the youngest one are around. And this is where the grove is spreading, and this is where the grove is disintegrating. And that's in fact the cycle. That this was first grassland, became a grove, and now again becomes grassland. And when the grassland is big enough, then the light demanding shrub species appear again, and then the whole cycle starts again. And this is in fact what happened in a wood pasture system. It is called a non-linear cyclical succession. So there is no end situation of only forest, because the forest disappears again and it goes back where it started. What you can see, it all started with grazed open grassland. Then you get the thorny shrub species. They become established in the grazed open grassland. Then you get solitary strips, shrubs, and you get spreading scrub. Solitary shrubs are, for instance, hawthorn, and spreading scrub is the blackthorn, but also the bramble. And so you have all the species that have thorns or are not eaten by the animals. Then you get the tree seedlings growing up, protected by the thorny species, and then you get solitary trees or closed canopy groves, and the herbivores prevent the regeneration, and here you get the disintegration, and then you are in grazed open landscape again. And this regeneration takes place with a biomass of large herbivores from up to 200 kilograms per hectare. That may be a number, what does it mean? But if you look what the foresters say, which is about the maximum to be allowed in a forest for a good regeneration of trees, it's 8 kilograms. So you can imagine that these wood pasture systems had a very high carrying capacity for herbivores compared to a closed canopy forest, if you still wanted a successful regeneration. And the difference is the foresters want the regeneration within the forest, and there it is outside the forest. Now, could you say, what about cattle? Cattle is a domestic animal, so it's an agricultural landscape. Yes, but cattle is in fact a domesticated aurochs. So the cattle and the aurochs are the same species. So cattle is not what many people say, an alien species introduced by man and therefore does not belong into nature and has to be removed, which was one of the arguments to get them out of the wood pasture. No, they are part of it. They belong to it. And here you see what happened. This is the Burg in the Paradies. You have the grass eaters, horse, cattle, aurochs, tarpon, grazing. You have the wild boar, I didn't mention him, but he uproots the soil. And in fact, he's the gardener of the natural situation because he creates a germination niche for all kinds of plant species, but also especially for the hawthorn and for the blackthorn because they need open mineral soil to germinate. And so you get the scrub, and the scrub is eaten by the roe deer and the moose. So there is a counter effect between the grazing animals who facilitate the establishment of the thorny species while they browse it and also the trees. So there is a kind of balance. And finally we have the red deer and the European bison who eat merely grassland, but during the winter they start to debark the trees and help to have the cycle going faster because they kill the trees. So large ungulates in high densities, they drive the succession in concert in a wood pasture, creating a more or less open park-like landscape. And that's what I wrote in my book. And that's what I said. This, in fact, can explain why oak was still in the pollen diagram. And therefore, the wood pasture is, in fact, the same system as the original natural vegetation with all the large herbivores. And you can imagine that this is very rich in plant species because there are grassland species, meadow species, there are tree species, there are butterflies here. Here you have the trees where you have the butterflies like the purple emperor and species like that. All these species are facilitated by this kind of landscape. Wood pastures also cast a different light on Sylvius Horrida. It cast the light of language. I told you about Tacitus, who had those Latin texts, and what was important, Germania was Sylvius Horrida. That means it was a terrible forest, it was a dark forest. Sylvius Horrida. Horrida means bristling. So what's the sense? It was a bristling forest, what he saw there when he went in Germania. How can you explain that? That's very strange. We have a plant species called Genista horrida, which is a species with very many thorns. So what in fact said is there were thorny forests. We know those from Africa, the acacia, but do we know them from Europe? So what does he mean with those so-called, were it thorny forests? If the wilderness was like a wood pasture, what I assume, in the clumps of trees, and a clump of tree is Sylvius because it is trees together, so it's plural, surrounded by thorny scrub, which made them horrida, because it were the thorny scrub which make the appearance horrida, bristling. And if it would have been awful forest, it would have been horribilis. So it's a different word. So Tacitus in fact said, when he described Germania, the land, even though it's quite diverse, in generally is either thorny in groves, and that's an ablativus limitationis, or swampy in marshes. And the ablativus limitationis, that's the fifth fall. And the people, the teacher Latin told me that it's very difficult to learn that to pupils, because they only can think in four falls. That's what they know from German and things like that. So that is the misunderstanding. In historic documents, scientists read the word forest, forêt, wald and woud, and it means nowadays a closed canopy forest. And what I said earlier, historians said, okay, you were right with your interpretation by the pollen and all the things that the uncultivated last wildernesses were a closed canopy forest. The word forest and the word forêt is derived from the word forestus, and the word forestus had to do with Roman law. Roman law was that forestus would have been derived from the Latin foras and foris, which means the outside, outside the door, outside the cultivator. That means outside the settlement, outside the crop fields. And what was outside there was the uncultivated, there was the wilderness. And the Roman law said, what is outside that and doesn't have a clear owner belongs to the emperor. We still knew that in our laws as res nullius. That means it belongs to nobody, like wild animals. And if it belongs to nobody, it belongs to the emperor. And the Merovingian and the Carolingian kings on the continent took that over in the 6th and the 7th century. And they said, the outside belongs to nobody, and therefore it belongs to me. And they declared the wilderness as forestis nostra, our forestis. And here you see a map from the 16th century, 1576, with the border of East Prussia and the Polish kingdom. And here you see a European bison, here you see a red deer, and here you see also a bison. And probably these animals lived in the wild. And these animals lived in the forestis. And this area was then brought under the jus forestis. And that meant that the king was allowed to say whether you were allowed or not to take a tree or to take grass or to take an animal from that area. And he appointed people in a kind of court where the decisions were made what you were allowed and what you were not allowed. And those servants there, they were called the forestarii, the foresters. And so, for instance, he said, nobody except me is allowed to hunt red deer and to hunt European bison or to hunt auroch. That's my privilege. Although you are allowed to graze your cattle there, because in that time nobody could forbid people from settlements to fulfill the needs of their household. That means, what do you need to keep alive? And here you see them. The point is, these animals are merely grass eaters. They can't survive in a closed canopy forest. So these animals and these maps tell us something about what this landscape must have looked like. So the wilderness and the wild animals lived in an area that was deserted by people, uninhabited by people. It was empty. Otherwise, the kings could not have it declared as forestis nostra. And here you see a Latin text. This is the Polish kingdom, and it says desertim regis Poloni. It means it was the empty land belonging to the Polish king, a desertum. This is a painting from a Dutch painter, Geertje tot Sint Jans, from the 15th century, and it says St. John in the desert. doesn't make sense, does it? Because this is not a desert. That's a park-like landscape with trees, shrubs. There's even, I will later show it, a deer here. There are shrubs, there are birds, there are flowers. A desert. So, St. John in the desert. Here you see the deer, here you see the shrub, here you see the birds. Is this a desert? So people would say, ah, it's a fantasy. This man did not really know what he painted. This is a desert. So he should have painted St. John in this landscape, where he was also, according to the Bible. However, this is not only a desert, it is also deserted. It is empty. There are no people. Would that be something that those two things have in common? Not being a desert, but both being deserted, empty of people, not people living there. That means a wilderness. Is this deserted? Yes. Well, here's some houses, but this is deserted. You must know, if people from the 15th century, like Jan van Eyck, made paintings, they always situated what they painted in their time. So van Eyck lived in the 15th century, and this is the Holy Mary with Jesus. So he paints it in a situation of the 15th century. That's what they did. So what Geertjen tot St. Jans will have done is he painted St. John in what in those times was considered to be the desertum, the empty land. Not the desert, but the deserted. So St. John in the desert is St. John in the uncultivated wilderness, owned by nobody, brought under Roman law. And if you read description from the Middle Ages about hermits, which in fact St. John was, that were people who retired in the wilderness to get complementation, to think over. The description is like a wood parcel. There was a lot of fruit, there were thorns, there was open landscape. So this man, in fact, shows us how the wilderness looked like. Here you see a settlement in the 15th century. Here you see an oak tree, and here are the pigs. This man kicks out with sticks the acorns for those pigs. This is a picture also that has to do with language. These men look over a kind of fence. That means this is the inside, and that's the outside. And the outside, the forestus, was called in common language Wald. That's a German word. The Dutch word is Woud. The Anglo-Saxon word is Weald. So the Weald was not a closed canop before. The Weald was the uncultivated, which was the outside, the cultivated. And here, this is also important. These pigs are fattened on the acorns. I will make clear later on why. This is an oak wood in the wood pasture in Transylvania. And you see, this is open grown, and it has a huge crown. That means it has a huge number of leaves and therefore can produce a lot of acorns. Such a tree has about 20 more biomass on leaves than a forest-grown oak. So you can imagine it produces a lot of acorns. That's the reason probably that people were very preferable for these open-grown trees, because they produce so many acorns. Because why? Why were acorns so important? The acorns of an oak were in fact the pasture for the pigs. So today we know an oak as a forest tree, but in that time it was known as a pasture for the pigs. And what was it important? Because for the bacon. And the bacon was salted and it was the most important food for the winter. If you salt and dry a ham from a pig, you can preserve it for about 3 years. So it was a way of storing your energy. It was the fat who gave you the energy for the winter. And it was not the wheat and the bread, that was not so important. It was the bacon that was important and preserved by drying and salting it. So the pasture for the pigs was called the akker, the acre, the ekker, because in Anglo-Saxon the word for acorn is akker, ekker. So what we now, what at that time was an acre, was quite different. It was an area where the production of akker was, acorn, there were oaks, but today it is this. So there was a total change in the meaning of that word. But the problem is people read now in an historic text, people were creating akker. They say, oh yes, they all cut the trees. So the Middle Ages are the times when we created the fast open arable land areas for producing crop. This is a card from the 19th century for Germany. And here you see the connection between the pigs and the acorns. Akker, acre, ekker. Saxon word for acorn. And an acre, you still in Britain have the word, was the measurement of a piece of land where you could must fatten a pig when there was a full acre, a full akker. And still in Germany and in the Netherlands, when you were fattening the pigs, they call it akkeren. In English, the word got lost because it was taken over by the French word le panache, pannage. So also because the change in the language, you lost the connection with the past in Britain. So when there was a full must, there was a full akker. And the trees who produced the akker, the most important one was the oak, but also the wild pear, the wild apple, the wild cherry, they were called bearing trees, fruitful trees, and they were under the jus forestus. Only with a very special permission you were allowed to cut an oak. And you had to show that you needed that oak for your house. Otherwise you were not allowed to take it. There were heavily punishment if you cut illegally an oak. And that were the so-called mirror punishment. And if you cut an oak, then your head was cut. Or if you took the bark of an oak, which was very important for the leather production, then you had to undo what you harmed the tree. So the forester came, the forestarius, he put you to the oak, cut open your belly, like here, took out your intestines, nailed them on the tree, and turned you around the oak until you had all your intestines around the tree. And in that way, you had to heal the wound of the tree. So you see, those people really lived in harmony with nature. However, there was one thing in all those punishments. Mercy was before punishment. So probably they were never implemented, those punishments. They just served to frighten your people to do that. Although it didn't help much, but anyway. So here you have a picture, and this is Leo Linhart. He is in Cape Town, and he sent me this picture because I had an idea. There is a connection between oak, acorn, and oak. But I couldn't find it in text. I knew there was the word akkerboom, which means an oak. So there is the connection with akker. And he showed me this oak in the botanical garden in Cape Town. And look to this sign. Here it is. Kwerkersrober, European akker, European oak. So in Afrikaans, the word remained. And probably because they didn't have the change in agriculture, which I will show afterward, which is the cause that we lost the connection of akker, which is now arable land, connected with an oak. And that had, this is European akker, and that had to do with potato. I will come on later. So when you read in Middle Age text, they created akker, this is what they did. They planted oak. This is a plantation from 150 years ago in Germany. And they planted the oaks for the acorns, for the pigs. And the most important function of trees at that time was not timber, at least not on the continent. It was must for the pigs. And of course, these limbs were also used for shipbuilding, the ribs of the ship. But the most important, it was a byproduct. The most important things were fattening the pigs. And then came the potato. It was introduced by the Fischocrats, French people, in the new agriculture. And they said those common lands, because everybody had the right to use to fulfill the needs of his household in the wilderness, which was in fact common land because everybody was allowed to use it. They said, if we want to improve the production of agriculture, you should not have common land. You should divide it among the people, because if somebody does a lot of efforts to level up the production, he doesn't have the benefits from him in common land. So they said, we should divide the common lands. And then all those common lands were divided and they became private property. And then the potato became the main food for the pigs. And that was the moment that the pigs were not driven anymore in the wilderness, but they were put on stables and they fed on potatoes. And the potato had another advantage. It was a very good food for humans. You could feed 4 times more people from 1 hectare of potatoes than you could from 1 hectare of wheat. So the potato really caused a revolution in the land use. And what they see is that the oaks disappeared from what was called the akker. That means where the akkers were. But because it remained the place where the food for the pigs was produced, the potato, the name remained. And here you say that the oaks were cut, some of them were uprooted, and we still have names in the Netherlands which is called rooiakker. And rooien is the Dutch word for uprooting. So in all kind of names you still find the whole process described from getting from an area with oak trees for the pigs, finally uprooting the trees or removing the akker from the akker, while the akker remains the akker for the potato. You see, it becomes very disturbing with all those words because you lose the meaning of it. And so the word akker became what it is now, arable land. So within a century, the meaning of the word evolved or changed 180 degrees. With the danger that nowadays people extrapolate the modern meaning of akker simply to the past. And that's the biggest pitfall for language. Words remain the same, but the meaning evolves. So there was livestock grazing in the forests, and the forests and forêt means also wood pasture. It was the area where grazed. So people would say, where's the grassland then? Yeah, but also, why grassland? People would say, I don't find it in the text, so there was no grassland. But how could those animals then have been fed? There must have been grassland, because otherwise your cattle would have died. You don't find the sources of grassland, and why not? Because twigs with leaves were cut as food for cattle, were the pasture. So a tree was a pasture. Oh, sorry. Well, a tree was a pasture. We think nowadays a pasture is grassland. No, a pasture is where the food is for the animal. And it's called in Saxon weide. Weide. So a tree is a pasture. So why would somebody wrote down in the Middle Ages we had grasslands and trees if it would have mean there was pasture? Because everything was pasture. And the pasture was covered by the word forestus, fore, because fore was inclusive pasture. And we still know they very much like it. So the fodder was cut and then dried for the winter, and that was a very important winter food. Not just the hay, what we think nowadays. No, it was also the leaves and the twigs. So trees were not considered to be different from grass. So in the mindset of those people, there was not an opposition between grassland and forest. Therefore, you don't find any notice of grassland. You only find a notice. You could feed your cattle in the forest. So it must have meant there was grassland, otherwise you could not feed them. Flowering trees were also pasture for the bees, like the lime. And almost treeless raised bog were called forestus, wald, because it was the uncultivated. So even treeless areas were what at that time called a forest. And in Dutch, the word forest became forest, but we lost it. We have still it in the word forst. In German, it became forst, and in French, it was also forest. And that's the word William the Conqueror brought over to England. But later on, the French skipped the S and it became a forêt. So if William the Forer would have done it a few centuries later, you would have your forêt law and not your forest law. So the word was much older than 1066, than William the Conqueror came. It goes back on the continent to the 6th and the 7th century. So the wood pasture and everything which is connected with that is totally gone after the invention of modern forestry in Germany in the 18th century. And this is a man who wrote a landmark book. I already mentioned to me earlier. He is Heinrich von Cotta. And the book is from 1816. He said the sentence, the famous sentence, if mankind would leave Germany with 100 years, it would be totally covered with forest. And this was the end of the wood pasture. Because instead of regenerating in the thorny scrub, they regenerated within the forest. And if you regenerate in the forest, there are no thorny shrubs because they can't grow under the canopy of those trees because they are light demanding. And what they developed then was the shelter wood cutting. That means they cut some of the trees so that more light was cast on the forest floor and the seedlings grow up. And they developed it at first with the beech, which is very shade tolerant. So they kept this shelter against drought and late frost. Was beech for almost 40 years. So after 40 years, they removed the last trees, and then you had a new generation. And that way of forestry didn't want cattle and horses in the area. And the foresters called it natural regeneration, which it isn't. It's an artificial regeneration. So that's also with language. If as a biologist, I started to read books. How do trees regenerate naturally? I came upon this, natural regeneration. But it is not what they do in natural. It is a technique which developed in the 19th century. In this situation, the farmers were not allowed to graze, and the foresters wanted to get rid of all the cattle, the horses, the sheep, and the goats, because they would trample and eat the new generation which rose up in the grove, in the forest. They are not protected then by the thorny scrub, because the thorny scrub is light demanding and they can't thrive under the canopy with the fuel light, with only this gap has left where they had the new generation. So from that time on, and that's around the first half of the 19th century, you see really an action of forests to get rid of all the grazing in what was then the wilderness, which was the forest, the uncultivated. Moreover, what was important with the oak, this is what they developed with beech. And the last beech they removed to get this new generation was 40 years. And then they said, okay, we are going to replicate that for the oak. This is the oak, this is in the Forêt de Troncet in France. Here you see the oak seedlings and here you see the old oaks. So what they did is you had a canopy, they thinned the canopy. Then there is more light on the remaining trees. They form fruits, more acorns, they fall on the soil and you get all the seedlings. And then they kept these trees, like with the beech, for about 40 years. And all the regeneration failed. All the seedlings finally died because of the lack of daylight. And then they discovered, if we regenerate the oak, and it took them almost 50 years successively to find out, we have to remove the last oaks within 10 years. So after 10 years, you find all the oak seedlings with their head in full daylight. So it was quite different from the natural regeneration, because they call this also natural regeneration, from the beech. So here you see what they call natural regeneration of oak. These people are destroying all the herbs, all the grass, all the elms, all the beech, all the hornbeam, because these are all plant species that compete with oak for daylight and may the oak natural regeneration to fail. So my conclusion was, so oak cannot regenerate naturally. And then you see, because the foresters did not want anymore these grazing animals, they concentrated on trees to produce wood as material, not wood as wood, but wood as material, another language problem. Wood is not always wood, but wood means also wood, not wood, that means the material. So you can wood from one tree. So you didn't need, you don't need a wood for wood. So now, that's enough. So they wanted to have a separation of pasture and wood production. And so you see that the wood pasture disappeared in two ways. First, some of them were changed in purely grassland, created for livestock. And so the word pasture went from an area, a wilderness, where there were also trees, to an area where there are only grasses and herbs. And the word forest remained to where the trees were, but only trees. No grazing animals in it, or if there were wild animals, they were culled to very low densities. And the open grown light demanding trees are dying out in what was forest reserve, former wood pasture, and together with them, the origin and the knowledge of our culture. That means, why was St. John in the desert? What about the word foresters? What about the word pasture? What about the word akker? It all got lost. So the last linkages to wilderness and culture in Europe are just slipping away unrecognized. And I think if we say we have to preserve our culture, that's a very bad thing. So what in fact we are doing now is tearing all the pages from our culture book, and the only thing that's left are the last pages. And people think then that we know the whole history. We don't. We only know a tiny place. And moreover, with what is on the last pages, we can't understand what happened before. because of the change of the meaning of words. So, in my opinion, and that's what I learned from my search for what wilderness was. The wilderness, the search for wilderness, brought me through all the layers, cultural layers, because the wilderness is the bottom line, and every art is derived from that. And looking for that, I went through all those layers and came upon pages about culture that I didn't know hear from other people. Thank you for your attention.